Thank you, Bob. As you guys have heard me say so many times, we understand, as well as anybody, the importance of investing in infrastructure. And as your water utility, we're happy to invest about over $25 million this past year in infrastructure to make sure that you have the service that you expect every day when you turn on the tap. And our customer service representatives are there to help whenever, and my team just does a really fantastic job. I'm so proud of them. But we wanted to help educate people in the community, people in the state, on the infrastructure needs. And I'm sure that some of the conversation today will be about infrastructure in the state and how that gets paid for and how all of that works. So what we've done is we've paired with Kentucky League of Cities. And on October 14th, for those of you who are interested in the impact of infrastructure on economic development related to water and wastewater needs, we're gonna have a session here in Lexington. Again, partnering with Kentucky League of Cities to help educate people on the infrastructure needs in the state, as well as funding mechanisms and all kinds of great information about how to make that work. And again, we understand the importance of it and continue to make those investments. And so we would love to have as many of you come to that event. It's an all-day event, but I think you will learn a ton. So we'd like to welcome you to that. So I want to give a special thanks to Bob and Andy for putting on these events. We've been so excited to sponsor these events all these years, and they just do a great job of bringing in great speakers and just makes us proud to be part of that organization. So Bob, you and your team have just done a fantastic job. So let's give them a hand for the great job they do. And so now I have the pleasure of turning it over to the people that you really want to hear from, the person that you want to hear from, Matt Bevin. And Matt, we're so glad that you took the time to come and talk to these business leaders today. We're very excited to hear what you have to say. And Carla Blanton is, for those of you who don't know Carla, she's a fantastic leader of our Public Policy Council and just does a fantastic job. And we're thrilled to have her here to be able to do an interview type, ask some questions, and help lead the discussion today with Matt. So I'm going to turn it over to Carla and Matt, and you guys have a great conversation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Cheryl. And just want to thank all of you for being here today. We have a great opportunity to hear from the Republican nominee, who many of you, maybe like me, have not heard him yet live in Unfiltered. So we're looking forward to the conversation. And rather than me go through a long bio and tell everybody about you, I think it'd be great just to have you spend a few minutes talking about a little bit about your background and why you're running for governor.
Excellent. No, thank you all. I appreciate the chance to be here. I feel kind of like a little kid in this really big chair here. So if I suddenly sink in and disappear, I apologize in advance. And for those of you who are sort of on the wings here, I'll try to pivot from time to time so you don't look just at the back of my head. But I appreciate you. I mean, I know this is part of what you do, but it takes out of a day that you would otherwise be gainfully employed doing something else. So thank you for taking the time to be here. I'll tell you briefly about myself, my background. I grew up in a fairly humble way. Some of you know this and have heard this. Others I am meeting for the first time. And I grew up the second of six children, grew up in a rural environment, raising crops, raising animals, very simple life, not too different than so many folks, frankly, in this state and in this country, probably many in this room. But it was financially humble, well below the poverty level. So I don't approach some of the things we'll be talking about with just a pure level of sympathy, but rather of empathy. And when you talk about being uninsured and being kind of financially in need, I have empathy for that. I've been there, and I do have appreciation for it. But I'm grateful that I was raised in a home with a couple of things that as I've gotten older, I'm most grateful for. And that is, I was raised in a home with a strong work ethic. You give an honest day's work for an honest day's pay. You don't take something that you didn't earn. Those were foundations that, frankly, have served me well. I'm grateful as well that I was raised in a home with strong Christian values. And I'm grateful for the fact that I was raised to let my yes be yes, my no be no, to treat people the way I would want to be treated, to respect God, to respect my parents, to respect other people. And so I'm fortunate for that. I was very involved in 4-H. That was pretty much my only social outlet as a kid. First time I ever flew in an airplane, actually. I was 17 years old. I won a trip through 4-H to Washington, D.C. Addressed the U.S. Department of Agriculture there to represent 4-Hers across the country. I went off to college. I went to Washington and Lee University in Lexington, Virginia. I just previously, before coming here, was speaking to a bunch of young college students. And one of them came up and introduced herself to me, and her father was younger than me at Washington and Lee, so I'm not getting any older, but everyone else I went to school with apparently is. So I graduated from W&L, went into the military. I was an active duty Army officer for a number of years, but I got out of the military 20-some-odd years ago, and since that time, I've been a business person. I've been like so many of you in this room. I own all or part of 10 different companies now. I've spent the bulk of my life in the working world in the private sector, in the pension management business, asset management business. We'll talk about that. It's part of why I'm in this race. The companies that I own range from base level manufacturing to investment management to software to medical devices, etc. I'm an entrepreneur. I'm somebody who puts seeds in the ground and nurtures the seeds that others have put in the ground. I started a firm here in Kentucky in the basement of my home initially that today manages over $5 billion in pension assets for retirement plans, both for states and corporations around the country. I'm married. I have 9 children, which for those who've heard that just for the first time, I know that seems like a very large number. We had 5 children. We did this to ourselves on purpose, though, because we had 5, and we adopted a 6th child. And then in the process of adopting little Jonah, we learned of a sibling group of 3 additional children that needed a home. The oldest was already 10. It's hard to find a home sometimes for 3 children together when they're not all real young as well. And once you've already got 6 kids, really, 6, 9, what's the difference? And I will tell you, we now drive around in a 12-passenger van. It's a large silver van. My wife refers to it as Apollo 12. And it is somewhat shuttle-like in its appearance. It's a sprinter van. But we're blessed. We really are. And I have been blessed to live the American dream. Somebody asked me why I'm running for governor, why I would want to be governor. And what I told that individual is what I will tell each of you. And I hope you do hear this and understand this. This is less a function of something that I want to do and more a function of something that I'm willing to do. And I firmly believe that we need more men and women like those in this room, people who are willing to serve the public, people who are willing to put themselves forward, to be the modern-day equivalents of the citizen legislators that the founders of this nation imagined when they thought about a government of and by and for the people. And so this is my motivation. That's a little bit of my background. And I look forward to our discussion. And again, thank you for being here.
Let's start off with the economy. I think it's something that's on everybody's mind, the uncertainty in the stock market, the low unemployment numbers, which don't seem to give a lot of people a lot of comfort. One of the problems seems to be we've got about the lowest labor participation rate in the last 40 years. Kentucky, I think, according to one publication, ranks about 47. Yeah. 47. What are your thoughts about how big of a problem that is and how it can be fixed?
It is a huge problem. For those of you in this room that are trying to hire people, people with anything beyond just the modicum base level entry skills, how difficult is it for you? I'm willing to bet fairly. There are thousands of jobs in this state right now that are going unfilled. I was just in northern Kentucky. In those 3 northernmost counties, there's about 700 to 800 skilled jobs unfilled right now. Warren County, Bowling Green, 850 jobs in Warren County alone unfilled. Hart County, which is on the I-65 corridor, Horse Cave. Most people wouldn't imagine that to be a burgeoning area of job opportunity, and yet there are more than 100 jobs unfilled, jobs that are starting at double the minimum wage. DART, which has a strong presence there, has said we could bring hundreds of jobs to Hart County and the surrounding area if we found people that could actually fill those jobs. The fact that they cannot should be of concern to each and every one of us. And so it's important for us to realize if they don't come here, they're going to go to Tennessee or Indiana. It does concern me as an employer that we have such an incredibly low percentage of our population working. Because we'll get into this as we talk about Medicaid expansion, et cetera. We cannot afford to have working age, able-bodied men and women who do not have any children sitting at home on your dime and not participating. We can't afford it. Regardless of whether people like the idea, think it's good, fair, whatever the case might be, it is financially untenable. It has got to change. And in fact, when people have the luxury of being able to do so, they sit at home and they invariably have the ability and the time and the inclination at times to participate in certain extracurricular activities that then preclude them from passing drug tests, among other things, to then assimilate back into the workforce. So it should concern us. The fact that we are 47th is not good given the fact that we have 25 trending toward 30% of our state on Medicaid right now. So not sustainable financially. It is something that is going to have to be addressed no matter who your next governor is. And we can talk about that as we move forward.
What do you think, we've talked a little bit about what the problem is, but fundamentally, how do you think we can move forward from an education perspective, from a workforce perspective, from a public policy perspective to get people qualified or able enough to fill those jobs?
I think we have to start with simple things. We have to start with things that frankly don't cost us money. Some things will cost us money. For starters, I will tell you right now, I'm not a professional politician. If you want somebody who's another version of the same old thing, I'm not going to be your choice. But if you want somebody to bring solutions to the perspective that are colored by not only a life experience of having walked in the shoes of a lot of people economically in this state, but also from a business standpoint, then I would appreciate your consideration. One thing we cannot have, if I am the next governor of this state, if you are a working-bodied, you know, able-bodied, working-age man or woman, and you do not have children, you should not be on public assistance. You just shouldn't. There's no reason why that should be a lifestyle choice. Increasingly, and many of you know this to be true, we've got people who are on these assistance programs who unfortunately don't want to work, take a job, because they can get cash on the barrelhead. There are Finnish carpenters that are on full benefits that'll work when they want to, occasionally at $25 an hour cash only. And people pay them because they have no alternative. We cannot make it easy for people to choose a lifestyle that comes at the expense of what's financially good for this state. We've got to have training programs, viable training programs. We shouldn't have two slots when there are 20 kids in a high school class that want to get into a vocational training program. We've got to make it a very intentional part of what we do. I met last week with the presidents of all the state's universities, and we had a conversation. There is concern, as well there should be. We, more than almost any other state, have cut funding to post-secondary education over the years. About $173 million we have cut over the last decade. How are we going to see some return of that, they wanted to know. And I agree, we cannot shortchange education, it's what we need. But what I made clear is that we are going to have to, if we want to encourage certain types of degrees, whether they are STEM degrees, whether they are skilled trades, whatever the case might be, we better incentivize the kind of behaviors and the types of programs that will produce those types of skilled workers. And if we say we want STEM degrees, we need outcomes-based funding, period, with respect to how we allocate the nearly $1 billion in post-secondary education that we use every year. And so we've got to be intentional, we've got to be specific, we've got to incentivize the behaviors we say we want. We need more vocational training. It is a false canard to tell young people in this state and anywhere in this country that every one of them need to get a four-year degree in order to attain whatever it is they would hope to attain in life. For many, that is not the right solution. We need post-secondary education, no question, but it's going to come in a variety of forms and fashions. And not everyone needs a four-year degree, especially if there's no productive end use for that, other than to incur tens of thousands of dollars in debt. And so I will intend to be very intentional, very specific. My budget will reward these types of behaviors. The budgets and the suggestions that I will bring to the equation, the things that I will incentivize as governor, will be very much driven by what is going to be in the economic best interest of our entire state.
Touch a little bit on tax reform. It's an issue that's been around for a long time, many task forces, many policy reports on it. But the devil's always in the details of how it's going to get done. What are some of your ideas about what a modern tax system would look like?
It would not look like the Kentucky tax system, sadly. It would not. I mean, ours is a very antiquated system. And we penalize some of the very things that we say we want more of. Why, as a state, let's be honest with ourselves, we are not going to likely be the next Silicon Valley, and that's all right. We're not going to be the next 128 corridor around Boston with medical ingenuity, and yet we have pockets of that, true enough. But what will we be great at? What can we be great at? What are we already great at, almost in spite of some of our own obstacles we put up for ourselves? Manufacturing excellence, specialized manufacturing. Many people don't appreciate, and many of you may be surprised to know, the number one contributor to our state's GDP, our number one export, is specialized parts related to avionics in the aviation industry. We could do more of that. We have low utility rates. We've got a geographic centrality. We've got riverways and roadways. We've got four seasons, none too extreme. We've got an abundance of natural resources in river and coal. We've got things that you could not buy at any price and move to another location. So let's take advantage of that. With respect to the tax structure, if we are to be a manufacturing hub for America, and we could be and should be, why are we taxing inventory in this state? It does not make sense that we force people to play games and play the shell game at the end of the year. We have what are called tax expenditures. It's code speak used by our legislators to give little loopholes and favors to people. There are more than 300 of these tax expenditures on the books in this state. They cost us over $10 billion in opportunity cost. Some of them we would all agree should stay there. Many of them we would not agree. There are some that, frankly, no one in this room would agree should be there. They shouldn't be there. We need to take a hard look at this. We need to look at where we're giving money away for no good reason and not getting, as business people, how you look at things, a good return on the taxpayer's investment. It is imperative that we think this way. Why are we one of six states that still has a death tax, an inheritance tax in this state? What is your incentive as successful business people, unless you are tied to the land you live on as your entire wealth? What is your incentive to live your last days in the state of Kentucky if you could move to Florida or Texas or some other place? And every one of you in this room knows people who have done it, are doing it, and maybe it even includes some of you in this room. And when you take your wealth to Florida, while their governor is here poaching jobs from us, and you all probably saw that the other day in the paper, when we do that, what do you take with you? You take your children and your grandchildren. And when your children and grandchildren go with you and the money changes hands, that capital does not get redeployed here in Kentucky. So we've got to be smart about this. We need to move to being more of a consumption-based tax economy and less of a production-based tax economy. Now, that said, it can't happen overnight. It's not going to be like flipping a switch. But I do believe let's lower corporate taxes and income taxes in ways that we can afford to do so. Every state around us has done it and or is doing it. We've got a trend in that direction. These are just a few. There are many things that we need to address on the tax structure as a state that will make us more competitive with other states around us and with states in this nation.
And there's a new federal workforce law that's aimed at increasing efficiency and effectiveness and accountability, and hopefully also introducing a little bit of flexibility for states and maybe hopefully realigning things, trainings, so that it fits with what the needs are of the employers in the state. What are your thoughts on the current system and how it could be improved?
Again, I think we're doing some pretty novel things here in the state, and I applaud us for that, not only within our school systems and some of our technical training programs that already exist, but could we do better? Yes, we could. This type of legislation only affords us the ability to do it even more intentionally than we have been. There are programs like the FAME program at Toyota, and some of you are familiar with that. If you're not, I would encourage you, Google it up, just FAME Toyota, put it into Google, read about this. It's innovative. It's creative. It is driven by the private sector in some measure, selfishly but appropriately, for their benefit. But who else benefits? We all benefit. Every single member of this state, every citizen of this state benefits by that type of forward thinking. And we need to replicate that. We need more of that. We need to come alongside and encourage that. We need to use our tax dollars to encourage that and incentivize more of these types of behaviors. Replicating programs like that, as I said earlier, vocational training. We need to work together, the state and the counties and the local municipalities, the municipalities, and ultimately and most importantly, the employers, the end user. We've got to create programs whereby the Volvos come here instead of to South Carolina. I'll digress for one quick second. Let us not kid ourselves, and I mean this with all due respect to who we are and what we offer people. But today, in this environment, right now, if Toyota had no presence in America, they would not likely put their factory here. If GE had no presence outside of their headquarters, they wouldn't likely choose Kentucky right now. If UPS was looking to locate a shipping hub right now from scratch, the odds that it would come to Kentucky, not high. If Ford was looking to expand, the odds that they would be here, not high. You could go on down to Quad Graphics, Lexmark, pick them. With rare exception, we would not be the first choice. We've got people now. I hear people ask me all the time, how can we attract more people here? Lord knows we want that, you want that, I want that, everybody wants that. But we better be very mindful of the fact that we better be just as cognizant of the fact that we need to come up with systems to prevent people from leaving. Because that's a bigger threat to us in the immediate term than not attracting new people to come. And it all goes back to what kind of an environment have we created. So I'm all about training a workforce that will lend itself to being a part of what Kentucky in the future looks like. The last thing I'll say on this is a verse in scriptures that without vision, the people will perish. True enough, and it is the same for this state. If we as a state do not have a vision for who we are, where we want to go, what we want to be, we will become a state that perishes. Economically, we will be untenable. We've got to address this. If we had half the pride and conviction in ourselves as Texas, gracious, they think they hung the moon in Texas. You wouldn't want to live in Texas this time of year and be outside on purpose. You really wouldn't. They've got, there's nothing, I mean, God bless Texas, but we will be better than that, I'm telling you.
What is your vision for economic development for the state, for bringing jobs? You mentioned retention, obviously, is the number one, but what for bringing new jobs?
Yeah, I mean, again, it goes to several things. First of all, I'm telling you, no matter where you stand on this issue, and just for the record, you know, I get every word I film. I apologize if the wrong word comes out of my mouth, you'll see it in a negative ad, because there are multiple people who follow me around and film every word that I say for Jack Conway. But here's the bottom line. We need to pass right-to-work legislation in the state. It's going to have to happen. And it isn't a function of whether we want it to happen. It is happening already from the bottom up. It has become a litmus test. It is something that is precluding us from being considered by the Volvos of the world. It has to happen. Ironically, the states in which union membership is growing the fastest are all right-to-work states. The number one state where union membership has increased 25% since the beginning of 2013, Tennessee. And why is that? Because in Tennessee, on an annual basis, they create more than 20,000 jobs a year, more than we do every year, and have since the downturn picked up in 2009. That's over 100,000 plus jobs just in the last 5 years. Think about that. Those are people that are working, people that are paying taxes. We've got to pass labor policies that, frankly, don't allow us to be eliminated as a litmus test. We've got to pass comprehensive tax reform, back to your question of a moment ago. And tax reform to some means raising everyone's taxes. Reform to others means cutting everyone's taxes. The reality of necessity is going to be something that is a combination of both, where we are thoughtful about how do we lower the overall tax burden without cutting off our nose to spite our face. These are things we have to do. If we do not address the pension crisis in this state, it doesn't matter what else we do. I'm telling you right now. And I hope we're going to talk about that in a moment. But we've got to address the fact that we have 25%+ of our population on Medicaid. Employers are not impressed by that. It's trending toward 30%. The fact that we are 47th in terms of work participation, they're not impressed by that. The fact that our education system has not exactly shot the lights out in recent years or any time in recent decades. They're not impressed by that. How are they impressed? They're impressed by the things that we are failing to take advantage of, things that we talked about earlier. And my job as governor will be to ensure that we get out of our own way with some of these other policies, because we can be great. We truly can be a beacon in this part of this country to other manufacturers.
One more workforce question, then we'll jump into pensions. Drug abuse is in the lack of qualified employees able to pass a drug test is something that we hear a lot about. What are your thoughts on how to curtail that drug epidemic?
Again, we cannot make it a lifestyle choice to not participate, to have no vested interest in your own personal outcome, to have no responsibility for yourself. What we have done, there is no able-bodied working age man or woman, or even those that are not able-bodied and not working age, who feel good about themselves by being a ward of the state or of anyone else. It flies in the face of who we are as human beings. And when we create an environment in which nothing is expected of somebody, while they may not be living large, they are able to live. And when we create an environment in which nothing is expected, we are robbing people of the self-respect and the self-worth that comes from doing for oneself as we are wired to do. And if you rob someone of the self-respect that goes from providing for oneself and one's family. You take their dignity away. You rob an individual of dignity, and you rob them of their humanity. You take away a person's humanity, and they make inhumane decisions about those they are surrounded with, about the neighborhoods in which they live, about the ways in which they treat their own body. And they end up finding themselves involved in drug activity, among other things, and crime related to the sustenance of that activity that ultimately is bad for every single person in this room and beyond. And it's easy to sit here and say they need to just get off of that. It doesn't work that way. You know that. Many in this room know people who've been addicted or maybe are addicted to drugs and alcohol as well. When a person becomes addicted, you don't just get off of it. Then it's on us. It's our responsibility at that point. An ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. We have got to, as a state, be intentional like a laser on spending money on the ounce of prevention to get out in front of this, because all we're doing by passing this and that and the other thing, we fix the pain pills, here comes heroin. We're going to fix heroin, it'll be something else. We're squeezing the balloon. We've got to address this at the root cause, and it starts by creating an environment economically where people have gainful employment and are expected to participate, expected to be what Thomas Jefferson spoke of as virtuous citizens, people not who are goody-goodies, but virtue in that work was a virtue, contribution was a virtue, being a member of society, constructively contributing to the fabric of who you are as a nation, that is a virtue. And unless we get back to understanding that, this will not go away. It won't.
Pensions, another fun topic for you. We talked a little bit about at the table, the Dow's down like 239 right before we came up here, and you ran some numbers.
I see you all reaching for your pockets now. Some are here like, oh my goodness.
So it's a pretty massive problem about meeting existing obligations, what to do with current and future retirees. Where do you see the answer coming in?
It's important to understand. I mean, we have, as many of you are aware, one of the least solvent states in America. We were just downrated last week by S&P, between S&P, Moody's, Fitch, et cetera, I mean, all the rating agencies. We are second from the bottom, third from the bottom, fourth from the bottom. On average, second to third from the bottom. That's not acceptable. It's not sustainable. We can't print money. We can only borrow it. And if you are a credit risk in the bottom decile, or the bottom aisle, as we are trending toward, then ultimately, the cost of borrowing is also something that we can't sustain. So where are we going to get our resources? We've got to address this pension crisis because it is the reason why we're being downgraded. We have used an assumed rate of return, 7.5%, 7.75% on various plans that frankly is unsustainable as well. We're not getting those kind of returns. The market's down, what, maybe 3% year to date? We are not getting 7.5. What's the difference between 3 and 7.5? It's a delta of double digits. Think about this. What we are assuming, what we are accruing for, what we are factoring in with respect to trying to trick ourselves into believing we're not in as bad shape as we actually are, is when you talk about 10 percentage points on $10 billion, it's $1 billion. I mean, how much we've dug ourselves into the hole in the last couple of weeks as the market has declined, we have become billions more underfunded in the last 2 to 3 weeks. Billions more. 2 years ago, we moved to what was called a hybrid plan. It's essentially a cash balance plan with a guaranteed rate of return. What is that guarantee? It's 4%. How many in this room right now would like to end this year with a guaranteed 4% return on your investments? I would think most of us would. But who's actually paying the 4%? You are. You can't afford to. The difference right now, let's say we're down 3 in that, that's 7% differential. That's on the plan that was supposed to fix this. We didn't stop the bleeding. We can wrap it in whatever gauge of gauze we want. We can pride ourselves in using this type of topical ointment or that. But if we don't stop the financial hemorrhaging, it is irrelevant what we do. It doesn't matter. We've got to change it. The demographics do not afford us the ability to continue to have defined benefit and defined benefit-like programs for retirees in this state. Our state nor others can afford it, but ours above all, because we're so financially strapped. There were 7 workers when these plans were put into place for every single retiree. Then it was 6, then 5, then 4, then three. It's two and change to one. Soon enough, it'll be upside down. It will drive itself into the ground. It is financially impossible. If you make on average $60,000 a year as a state employee, and you make 1.8 in your 30 years, and you happen to be a supervisor in your last five, and you made 120, so your high five is 120, and you're 30 years, and you started at 25, you retire at 55, so you got 30 years, you're 55, you get 75% of your high five, you retire making $90,000 a year, you live from 55 to 95, which is very much realistic and likely for many people. So in those next 40 years of not working, you make $3.6 million, and you made 1.8 when you worked. And instead of seven people carrying you, there's one who's making $60,000 and paying you. How does the math work? It does not work. And I would defy anybody, no matter how much you like the idea of continuing it, it is impossible. It is impossible. If we don't address this, we're in big, big trouble. No matter who the next governor is, it must be addressed. And we had a 30-day short session that we just came out of this year. 750 different ideas were brought forth in committee. Not one of them, not one, seriously addressed this issue. The only one that even made a token effort, House Bill 4, that was going to bond $3.3 billion, stick it to our children and grandchildren, hoping that when they come due, they still live here to pay it off, which is increasingly unlikely the way we're going, and patch one-third of one hole in one underfunded plan. Not the solution. We've got to move to a defined contribution plan, period, no matter who your next governor is. And I intend to be your next governor, and I think increasingly it looks like I will be. And this I want you to understand is what I'm thinking as we move forward. It needs to be a defined contribution plan. It needs to be a plan that frankly puts the onus on the individual to save with complementary support from the state, just as it is in the private sector. That affords people transportability and also the responsibility for taking care of themselves. This has to happen. We cannot afford to do otherwise. To do otherwise will prevent us from meeting the inviolable contract obligations that we have to our current employees and current retirees. We will not be able to make those checks do anything but bounce if we don't get this done. So if we are to meet the obligations, which we legally and morally must, to meet those obligations that are currently in place, we've got to change the plan going forward. We've got to give incentive to younger employees, frankly, those in the existing plans who may want to opt out. Voluntarily, it'll be an option. But if they choose to, they could say they're under 30 years old, under 7 years of service. We'll look at actuarial tables and figure out what the right initial threshold would be. They would be able to voluntarily opt out, take a lump sum. Yes, that exacerbates the problem a bit because that's one less dollar to pay a need. But if we know that we have $3 of need for every dollar going in, it's not working anyway. So we have a short-term dip. We'll figure that out. We'll find a way to make that work in the budget. But by removing that dollar now, we save ourselves $3.57 down the road. Has to happen. So these are a couple of the things that we've got to do. I mean, I have more thoughts on it, but I know you have other questions. So it has to be addressed because our state cannot afford to do otherwise.
Let's move on to the Affordable Care Act, which is a big issue for the business community. And also taxpayers, as soon the state will be responsible for paying 10% of the increased folks who came on as a result of the Affordable Care Act. Some estimates say that might be more than $200 million. And that's on top of the $1.3 billion a year that Kentucky already pays into the traditional Medicaid costs. Moving forward with that, taking that $200 million off the table when there are all these other needs that we've touched on a bit, how do you see that playing out? Would you continue with expanded Medicaid?
Again, it goes back to what we've said sadly several times in terms of what we can afford. I mean, think about this. First of all, how many of in this room really believe that although it's 100% reimbursement now, starting in 27, as was just noted, it will start scaling back 2.5% a year so that the federal government will reimburse 90% and we as a state will ultimately pick up the cost of 10%. That's over the next 4 years. That 10% is, again, very conservatively, 200. And given the light of number of people who've signed up, it'll be more like 250 to 400 million. Say it's $300 million. $300 million on top of the $1.3 billion. How many of you truly believe that the federal government's going to reimburse us for normal thresholds of Medicaid participants at 70-30, where they pay 70 and we pay 30? But they're going to continue to give us 90% when we put people on Medicaid above that threshold of need, up to 138% of the federal poverty level? You're kidding yourself if you think it's going to stay that way. It's going to go to 70-30 at least. We as a state are a beneficiary in that we pay 30%. Other states pay 50-50, some the other way around. I mean, we are a receiving state, a welfare state in that respect of the term. We receive more than we put in. But it will go at the least to that 70-30. So if we can't afford $300 million at 10%, can we afford $900 million more a year at 30%? That's if it's just treated like every other dollar that's reimbursed through CMS. This is not sustainable. We cannot afford as a state, again, whether you like it, whether you think it's fair, whether you think it's the right thing to do or not, there is not the money to be able to have 25 to 30% of Kentuckians on Medicaid. The way in which we resolve that is to create opportunity for them to be elsewhere. We made a very intentional effort to expand our Medicaid rolls because we could get free money. And our governor, who's not he's an intelligent man, but shame on him for misleading people as he has with these phony baloney reports from Deloitte and Touche telling us that this has somehow been a job-creating economic boon to Kentucky, that this affordable, not so affordable CARE Act and the expansion of Medicaid has created 12,000 jobs, he says, and has created $30 billion in economic opportunity for this state, he and this study say, and he touts it often. That's baloney. If that is in fact true, my suggestion would be, why wouldn't we put everybody in the state on Medicaid? Think about the jobs. Think about the money we'd make. Why not put signs at the border to say, hey, we're only 4.5 million people. We've got room for 6 at least. Come on in here, get on Medicaid. I mean, it's nonsense. It doesn't make any sense. We know how preposterous it is. So we've got to address it. We cannot afford to bleed ourselves dry. Because when we do it, we take from the very people these programs are in place to help. There are people, many in this room have been in the same boat that I was when I was young. This is not unique. There is need for people. There is. We need people to be helped by society. But when we give money to those who don't need it, we take from those who truly do. So my role, I'm just telling you, if I'm the governor of the state, we will not continue to be able to enroll people at 138% of the federal poverty level on Medicaid. It's not going to happen. And I'll leave it up to my opponent, Jack Conway, feels that the money's there. I don't know where. Apparently, you haven't been squeezed enough. So hold on to your wallets. There's two alternatives. We can squeeze more and more from fewer and fewer people, or we can broaden the economic base and take as little as we possibly can from more and more people.
What about the future of Connect?
Connect is a program. It's a portal to two things. Number one, people signing up for health insurance and people signing up for Medicaid. 80% of them to 81% of them have signed up on Medicaid itself. So we didn't need it. We had, as you duly noted, plenty of people, 850,000 roughly, that were already on Medicaid before Connect came into existence. We don't need it to be the conduit for people to sign up on Medicaid. There were people on Medicaid. There are people now. And when Connect is gone, there will be people on Medicaid at that time, too. The cost of maintaining this is, frankly, not something that we should be paying for, especially in light of the latest Supreme Court ruling. There is a redundancy. There is no advantage to a state now to have a state-level exchange, given that the subsidies that were supposed to be only for those with their own state exchange, and 34 states never set up any exchange. Many of those that did, besides ourselves, have already put legislation in place to remove them and or have shut them down already because they're smart enough to realize, why pay twice? We're paying at the federal level. Why pay again at the state level? We have not yet seen the light on that. And my belief is that why pay for the redundancy? And there are ideas out there, and maybe we could talk about them, that some have proposed as to how we can make money off of this. I mean, there's a good friend of mine, Senator Alvarado, who has a great idea, frankly, with respect to how could we actually try to make money on this by being an exchange that other states could sort of rent space on our platform. It's a good idea in theory. The reality is there's no marketplace for that. I have a brother who's a doctor who once said, you could come up with a cure for cancer, but if there's not a CPT code for it, no doctor's going to give it the time of day. And it's the truth. It's the truth. And sadly, it's true. And any of you who are in the medical community know what I'm talking about. If there is no market, nobody's clamoring for, hey, what state exchange can we get onto? They've got the federal exchange. And while it's good in theory, And I don't mean to belittle it, because it's actually a good idea. And we should test and make sure there really isn't a market. But I tell you, I've heard of no one, and I've talked to governors in other states who do not have a state exchange, and they are quite happy using the federal level exchange. So my proposal in 2016 during open enrollment is to take everyone on our federal level exchange, on the state level exchange, move them to the federal level exchange during open enrollment, as each of us is required to go through anyhow, move them, and those that can move will move. Those that are just pure Medicaid and don't even have a requirement to be on an exchange will be Medicaid patients just as they are now, or recipients, I should say, just as they are now. And then we will shut the Connect program down. There is no value to Kentucky. We've already had one governor get to go to the State of the Union address, and we've already used up all the value that's come of this. And while that was fun, I'm sure, for him, it's of very little value to us, and we've uncorked a cost on us that's unsustainable. And so this is my, and then in terms of then, how do we care for people? Let me touch on this quickly. This is critical. How we still will have great need. We're still a poor state. We don't suffer from too much access to too much health care in this state. So we as a state need to do what other states are doing, not only have been, but will increasingly be doing in light of this latest Supreme Court ruling. CMS, which oversees the distribution of Medicare and Medicaid dollars from the federal level to the states, will receive from states what are known as, and what we should apply for, as 1115 waivers. 1115 waivers are essentially asking the federal administrator, CMS in this case, for a block grant to take those dollars and to do at the state level things that are customized and unique to our needs, to allow us to empower the participant, to give them a vested interest in their own health outcomes. If you are somebody receiving Medicaid and you have an allocation of just, say, hypothetically $200 a month to cover your prescription needs, and you have the ability to get a prescription for $100 that's a name brand or one that's $10, right now, what's your incentive not to take the one you've seen on TV? Zero. But if you have certain dollars allocated to you, if we are entrusting you with a portion of those dollars by customizing something other than traditional Medicaid, and Indiana and others are doing this and doing it well right now, empowering that Medicaid population, giving them a vested interest in their own outcome. And the results are fantastic. You're covering more people with better coverage, better access at a cheaper price. And people ultimately, because they learn how to take responsibility, make thoughtful decisions with their money, which is our money collectively. Then they ultimately make decisions that allow them to stay on these benefits even less time, because they realize, you know what, I want more than just to be a ward of the state. These are the things we have to shoot for. These are the things that I will do as the next governor.
Okay. Touch briefly on the EPA and the new regulations on the Clean Power Plan. A lot of people look at it in terms of a focus on how that's going to impact coal, which it will, but also those low electric rates that coal has provided that have helped us become the number one producer of aluminum and number two in the auto industry. And it would require Kentucky to cut carbon emissions by 32%. How, as governor, would you help to protect Kentucky's low electric rates in light of those regulations?
We could have a long answer, and time doesn't afford us that, so I'll give you a short comment on this. Number one, there's never in the history of the world been more consumption of coal than there is today. Never. In the history of the world, how are we not participating? We sit on literally tons of it in two significant basins. We're blessed again with that relative to other states. We have the Central App Basin, we have the Illinois Basin, we have met coal, we have steam coal, we have tremendous ability to participate in this global demand. We have had cheap electricity rates. That has afforded us the ability to attract some of the people that we mentioned earlier may not come here now. It also has the ability, if we maintain it, to attract others like them if we get our house in order on other fronts. I put out, long before any other elected official in this state did, a press release about a year and a half ago now, the end of May, beginning of June of 2014, right after the EPA came out and said they were going to ask folks to voluntarily cut CO2 emissions and or have a plan submitted for them. And I put out a call not only to the governor but to our legislature to just disregard that. I told our governor, don't pay attention to that. We don't have responsibility. The EPA is not an elected body. We have no legal obligation to comply. This is imperative that people understand this. The 10th Amendment affords states an amazing degree of sovereignty and of autonomy that every time it has been adjudicated going back 150 years is the first time it was truly challenged in court. And there is case law and example after example where when in fact it ultimately is adjudicated, the states win. And if the day comes that the 10th Amendment actually does not bear any relevance to whether there is sovereignty and autonomy for a state, we've got bigger issues than this. So would it be taken to court? Of course it would. We have a separation of powers, executive, legislative, judicial. The only recourse against a state that stands on its 10th Amendment sovereignty would be to adjudicate this, to take this to court. That would happen. We would win in the end. There is an opportunity cost to things dragging out through court. This is what the EPA is doing right now. They said coal scrubbing technology. People said, great, we'll pay it, fine. Whoops, okay. We'll drag it out through the permitting process. We'll drag it out through the legal system, which ultimately creates years worth of delay, and these people have to make alternatives or the lights won't come on. 90%+ of the electricity in this state is still powered by coal. 37.8% in this country still powered by coal. There may be a future beyond the life of everyone in this room that may not include that as part of the energy in that day and age. But the bridge from where we are to wherever that might be is going to be built out of coal, not only in this country, but beyond. And that's just the actual reality of it. Germany, which has been a model for the world and for us to try to emulate with respect to sustainable energy, green energy, renewable energy. And they've pioneered many of the things that we're trying to replicate. What are they doing right now in Germany? As a result of this past winter, which was no different than it was for any of you in this room that were alive from 1975 to 1980, guess what? It's going to be another one this year. They're back, the cold winters. And guess what? It's not going away anywhere globally. This is the nature of things. But Germany, last winter, suddenly started having brownouts. They didn't have enough heat. They didn't have enough electricity. Right now, in Germany and throughout the European continent, they're building from scratch brand new coal-fired power plants. 6 of them in Germany alone, 18 on the European continent. And they are importing coal not only from their own continent, but from places like America as well. Why is that? Because they know that the future may not be this, but it's something that's going to be this for the foreseeable future. We need to participate. Kentucky, all the exported coal from this country to the world, and met coal in particular, is still highly in demand, although it's struggling because of the cost of production in this state and in this country. But 1.1% of all exports of coal come from Kentucky. Why are we not participating more on that front? If we had a governor that would lead on this, it's good to be a friend of coal. And I don't mean to be pejorative for those that wear a pin, for have the license plate, fantastic. But we need somebody to fight for coal, not just give lip service to it, because it is an incredible competitive advantage that we have. And trust me, if we continue the conversion of these power plants and we move to natural gas or whatever, your utility bills are going to go up bare minimum, 30, 40, 50%, and expect them to go up from there. People will be outraged. People will wonder why this happened, because we're asleep at the wheel, because we have elected officials that are not paying attention and are not fighting for the competitive advantages we have. Elect a governor that understands this, that understands the constitutional abilities of this state, and that is willing to actually do more than give lip service. Don't elect somebody who, when they ran for Congress in a district where nobody cared about this, was all for cap and trade. And now that they're running for governor, is a friend of coal and wants to fight the EPA. The only lawsuit that has been joined by the EPA, by our current attorney general, was joined because there was a unanimous decision by a committee in our legislature demanding that he do so. And he took that unanimous between Republicans and Democrats alike. Senator Brandon Smith chaired that committee, Natural Resources Committee. They unanimously said, join this suit, you're killing us in this state. And after 2 weeks of thought, he decided to do so. There's been no effort behind it. It's fakery. You need someone to fight for this state, not only on this front, but others. I'll say this to digress real quick, and I apologize. I know we're running short. If you had to leave your business to one of us, who would you leave it to? If you had to trust your business, the fact that it would still be in business a year or two or five from now, to myself or Jack Conway, which of us would you choose? This is what you need to think about in the next 53 days. If you had to bet that your children will be employed in this state now, 10 years from now, 20 years from now, and your grandchildren as well, and you had to trust that one of the two of us had any ability to make that happen, which of us would it be? And if the answer is clear to you on those questions, and it may be this way and it may be that way, think about that. But whichever direction is clear to you, go hard in that direction. And if you can't trust somebody with something of this size, don't trust them with this state. But you've got to be thinking, and you've got to make a decision. because where we are now and where we're going to be in 4 years, 14 years, and 40 years is going to start with what you do at the ballot box on November the 3rd.
Okay, well, let's open it up to questions from the audience, and no pressure, but a few that I did not get to in case you want to ask. Our local option sales tax, we talked about right to work, minimum wage, charter schools, and public-private partnerships. But
and if you don't ask, I'll hit them all real fast in the lightning round at the end here. Or at least the ones I can remember here. Any questions of any kind? Yes, sir. Sure. It's a good question. The question was, where do I reconcile the? And did you all hear the question?
No.
Okay. The question was this. As it stands with County Clerk Kim Davis and my support of her and the reality of separation of church and state, how do I reconcile that with my personal views as it relates to this race and my support of her is kind of a combination of the question. The bottom line is, and I mean this with all due respect to myself, my personal opinion on this is not germane. It's about what is the rule of law, what is equal protection under the law, what is the right thing for each of us. There was a fellow, Niemöller, who said in Germany, died in 1984. He ended up spending 7 years in a concentration camp. He said, first they came for the trade unionists, and I wasn't a trade unionist, so I didn't say anything. Then they came for the socialists, and I wasn't a socialist, and I didn't say anything. Then they came for the Jews, and I wasn't a Jew, so I didn't say anything. And then they came for me, and there was nobody there to defend me. If we don't think that our First Amendment rights matter, I don't care what your opinion on the marriage issue is. If you think the rights of anyone in this state, on any front, have the ability to suppress the rights of anyone else at any time ever, that is a slippery slope of danger. Because I'll tell you, it could suddenly be the other way around. My support of Kim Davis is this. We do have the First Amendment, a reinterpretation of the 14th Amendment, which is a ruling. And that's a whole nother issue, because the Supreme Court rules, any court rules, they do not make legislation. There is a ruling, it is an interpretation of the law, the ripple effect of which is that ultimately as it's then incumbent upon legislatures, be it the U.S. Congress or the states at their local levels, to come up with what is often referred to as enabling legislation, legislation that essentially will codify and put into law and make actionable the ruling and interpretation of the Supreme Court in this case. If you don't have that, there is a disconnect. It has ever been thus. This idea that, well, that's the law of the land. How many of you have heard it's the law of the land? There have been any number of instances where the law of the land flew in the face of any number of other people's opinions on anything. So we could go in a couple of different directions. I remind you, in 1857, the law of the land, Dred Scott, the same Supreme Court, said that blacks were inferior to whites and had the ability to be the property of whites. There were states, there were governors, there were legislatures that simply said, you know what, we beg to differ. We will stand on our 10th Amendment sovereignty. We will, in this case, be what were then ultimately known as abolitionist states. We had a president of this country. His name was Abraham Lincoln. Same thing. They were all disregarding the job. They did not quit their job. They didn't just do it or quit. They stood on their conviction because they also believed that there was a dignity and a respect for life, not only codified in the Declaration of Independence itself, but also in the Constitution, in the First Amendment. So it's important to remember that the rights of one are not suppressed by the rights of another. The biggest issue is this, though. There has been for years, especially since the 1970s, when we most specifically made a point to do so. It was somewhat irrelevant to that point because people always made exception for religious liberty. Starting in the 70s, we actually codified that a bit. And since then, we have made exceptions literally for people who were public employees on a bus who were asked to give out coupons for hamburgers, you know, to help improve ridership, and people who were vegetarians saying, you know what, it violates, I would rather not do it. Okay, make an exception. Not a big deal. We have people who are transporting, maybe there is, you know, Muslim, and that has been an actual case multiple times, that said, listen, I'm a truck driver. I don't want to transport alcohol as part of my route. Accommodations made. It should be no different now. And so my defense of Kim Davis is the fact that, frankly, she has a right to have an accommodation. I put forward a proposal on July the 10th, very specific, calling on our governor and our attorney general, who have been cowardly and silent on this issue. They have. It is his job, our governor and our attorney general as the chief law enforcement, to enforce the law. Where was the outcry for Jack Conway to do his job or quit when he failed to defend the Constitution, the law of this state? There was none. We can't have a double standard. You can't have that level of hypocrisy. And yet again, back to my opinion on it, is irrelevant in that we need to come up with solutions. As a governor, this is what I will do. I put forward a solution. It was remove the names of the county clerks from this form. Make it a downloadable form. Put it online, as other states have done, as Hawaii, which has been marrying same-sex couples longer than probably anyone in America, has done, a downloadable form. That form can then be taken to any justice of the peace or whoever, could then solemnize that. That deed would then be brought to the courthouse, just like any other deed or lien or mortgage, brought to the clerk's office, I should say, and it would be filed like any other one. It removes, then, the need for the clerk, in this instance, to essentially be the officiant on that document. That is the rub. It could be fixed like that. It should have been. This entire carnival that has been uncorked never should have been. Were there leadership in this state instead of partisan political decision-making? And this is how I will govern. If you don't want someone to come up with solutions and resolve things, don't vote for me. You have that option. If you want somebody to play games and uncork things that don't need to be uncorked, you have that option. Choose wisely. Yes, sir. It's a good question, and boy, I don't know how much time we have. I'll give you, if you haven't noticed yet, I'm not good at giving short answers to things, but I'm passionate about this. I am as serious as I can be about this job and what our state needs to do. Specifically to your question, we have not had a chance here in Kentucky to elect somebody that is unencumbered by anyone and anything since John Y. Brown came to Frankfort in 1979. That was the last time we had anybody come as unencumbered as I will have the ability to be. This is, frankly, I believe, good for Kentucky. It is equally unnerving to Republicans and Democrats alike, because nobody, the way it works in this town and in Frankfort, and you all know this, if you don't have a hook in someone, you want to make sure you have a hook in someone who has the hook in someone. And there is no hook. There's not a person in this state, there is not one person who has been promised a job. There is not one favor that needs to be paid back. There was not a single elected official, not one, who supported me or endorsed me during the primary. And that's fine. That's their prerogative. They were all somewhere else. This is wonderful. I got no favors to pay back. And the odds are I'm going to be your next governor. It's up to you to decide, but the odds are increasingly high, which means I will come with a blank sheet of paper. What will my administration look like? It'll look like people who, on average, have at least as much gray hair as I do. They are people with decades of experience in whatever area they're overseeing, whichever cabinet, whichever department. If they're overseeing transportation, they've spent decades in that arena. If it's insurance, decades in that arena. These are not going to be somebody's kid whose father once gave me a lot of money and that kid needs a job because he studied French literature. None of that nonsense. None of it. I'm going to have gray-haired people. One thing John Y. did well is he brought together professionals. He brought together people who he was agnostic, as will I be, with respect to party. I don't give a rip whether they're Republican or Democrat. The idea that we need to get our hands in the cookie jar now and we're going to pay back and we're going to get our turn, that's the thing that has been killing this state and others for far too long. Let's remove the partisanship and let's start governing as if we're being good stewards of the taxpayers' money. So I will bring adults. I will bring people with experience more than their elected status, with competence more than their connections. These are things that I'm going to look for. These are things that, frankly, my administration will be built on. And I'm already having conversations, and I would encourage every single one of you in this room, and I mean this sincerely. You can find me, mattbevin.com, mattbevin.com. If you have ideas for people that you think I should consider, I want to know them. I'm already starting them through the vetting process, a funneling process. I want to know who you think would be the right people in any respective area. I would ask you to send me four things: the person's name, what their qualifications are, what you think they would be good at, and how I can get a hold of them. That's it. One line on each. Less is more. This is what I need. If you think there's somebody that I should consider, why are they qualified? Where do you think they would add value? How can I get a hold of them? That's all I want. Feed them to me, because I mean, it's going to be like drinking out of a fire hose. One mistake that is often made is that you wait until you win, and then all of a sudden you got to transition, and you got to submit a budget. It's all of a sudden you're upside down. We're getting out in front of it, not to be presumptuous, but because we must.
Time for one more question. Okay, I'll ask it. Local option sales tax, where do you stand?
Local option sales tax, I spoke at GLI. If you don't get a long enough answer, I would encourage you go back and look at GLI. It's online, my answer to this and some other things. Local option sales tax, I'm not a strong proponent of it. And yet, at the same time, there are times and places where I think there is a case to be made for it, and I'm hearing that more and more from people. And so I'm always, again, I will come with a blank sheet of paper, including on ideas that I have on things. And there are certain business people in certain communities who have made a very compelling case to me within certain counties that this is actually something not only advantageous to, but very much desired by the majority of people in their communities. I will listen to that. I'm not a zealot for anything one way or the other. I'm willing to listen to good pragmatic thinking and people who can be apologists for certain things. My instinct is that we are already overtaxed as a state. If we were as quick to give voters the ability to vote taxes off their plate as we want to be able to allow them to vote them on, I'd be more of a proponent of it. Instinctively, I don't like it. I'm very familiar with it. I've studied it for years. I've looked at Oklahoma City, who pioneered this in some measure. They're going back for their third bite of the apple. I've been there. I've seen the waterfront. My brother used to live there. His daughter is a world-class rower, and in fact, they've got unbelievable world-class venues in rowing in Oklahoma City now because of things they've done through local ops and sales tax. There are advantages to it. It needs to be done right. The reason it failed this last time, among others, as it came through legislation, was because the enabling legislation was sloppy. It was too open-ended. If the sunset clause wasn't tight enough, the understanding of how, in fact, it would ultimately retire and what the restrictions were as to how it could be used was not well-written. I think if written properly, it's a possibility. But my instinct is not to add more taxes. My instinct is to tell us that less taxes is better and more desirable to people who come in. There were a couple other things. Minimum wage. Ask any small business owner you know. Go into a local coffee shop. Go into a local restaurant. Go into an independent hardware store. Go to your mom and pop, anything. Ask the owner of that business what raising the minimum wage by 40 to 50% will do to their business. If you find one person that says, this is good for my business, this will help me hire more people, this will help me stay in business, come back and talk to me, and perhaps you'll convince me that that's not a bad idea. There was one other thing on there real quick. P3. Again, I would encourage you that the state chamber did an interview with the chamber and spoke about this specifically. You'll see my thoughts on it. There's times and places, university housing, the University of Kentucky, the ROI is immediate even before you've started a break ground. There's places where P3 makes sense, infrastructure projects, key infrastructure projects that involve the interstate commerce and the movement of goods and services, where ultimately it's going to result in tolling that may then handcuff the ability of those communities to have any control over it. Not a fan of it. For key piece of Brent Spence Bridge in northern Kentucky, I think it would be a bad idea because it will lead to tolling. And that will not be good because ultimately now P3 legislation is increasingly being written to ensure the middle P, which is the private part, gets the fourth P, which is the profit, and who's to blame them. But there was a time when they got into these, the states were the beneficiary, but in the end, it got a $2 billion windfall when that P3 venture that they entered into on the highways went bankrupt. We've got to make sure that we don't stick it to citizens by not thinking this through carefully. So take a look. I give you a more thoughtful and lengthy answer in the interview that was done by the chamber, and that's on their website.
Thank you so much.
Charter schools. We need charter school. We need competition for our public education dollars in this state, period. We do. One of the reasons we lost money for Race to the Top was largely because of the fact that we are one of seven states in America that has zero competition for public education dollars. Let's not turn it upside down. Let's walk before we run. Let's start with our failing schools in Fayette County and Jefferson County, where the bulk of the failing schools, now generationally failing schools, exist. Let's give public charter schools a chance to take root. Give competition is a good thing. It is. It's healthy. It's cathartic. And frankly, it's the kind of thing we need to interject I'm a strong proponent of it. I will not only encourage such legislation, I would sign such legislation, and I will lead the charge to ensure that such legislation sees the light of day. Thank you.
Thanks.
I appreciate it.
That concludes our program. Thank you for your time. Sponsors, and thank all of you for being here today. Our next gubernatorial conversation, cover your ears, is going to be with Jack Conway on October 23rd.
Come and listen.
Thank you so much for being here. Yeah.